Last week we took the chapter of Af'al al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and inshallah we're going to take this chapter of abrogation, which they call Bab al-Nasakh. But just a brief review over what we took last week and some of the thamarat, some of the fruits that were taken from the Bab of Af'al al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and why it's relevant to us as Muslims and especially as students of knowledge. The other, can you just read the poem? Not in Arabic, it's just the English. Yeah.
Which one?
The chapter of the actions of the Prophet, peace and blessings. And that's how we can do, just do a quick review.
I don't think I found that one last time.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Anyone else have it with them? Who remembers some of the masail that we took, some of the issues that we talked about when we talked about the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
They're in two categories.
Okay.
Actions of worship and customary or natural actions.
Okay. So, and when we talk about sunnah, there are three ways that the sunnah is manifested. Whether the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam may
say
something, that's qawliya, or he may
do something,
that's fi'liya, or he may
have seen something and not said anything against it.
Right, and that's taqririya, right? He acknowledges something that was in his presence, right? Or maybe not in his exact presence at the moment. We talked about some other masail dealing with the Prophet's actions. Now, you said that it was categorized into two, actions of ibadah and actions that are customary. So an action of ibadah such as salah, right? The Prophet prayed. We say action of ibadah, it was an action that we see that was done towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then also there was a qawl, a statement that's accompanied with it. The fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed by himself, the fact that he prayed, does that exemplify or does that necessitate obligation upon every Muslim? If there was a hadith and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, you know the hadith of Ibn Umar, it's the hadith, explicit hadith of how the Prophet prayed. Okay? Is that hadith in and of itself a proof that the prayer is obligatory?
No.
This is the question.
It's a different opinion.
Right. That's what we talked about. Are the actions that are actions of worship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in essence, is each and every action of worship considered obligatory upon the Muslim? That's where there was what? Difference of opinion. How many opinions were there?
Three.
Why do these opinions matter to us? This is why we take, we don't want to stay theoretical. We want to bring it back to the practical application of your thought process, which in result will affect the way you deal with people, the way you deal when you hear a fatwa. This is why this class is so important. Because when you read fatwa or hear of a certain fatwa, you'll know, okay, but there's difference of opinion on that issue. It gives you freedom of thought. Freedom of thought that's backed up by sanctioned sources. Right? Instead of freedom of thought that's backed up by culture or emotions. Right? That's why Usul al-Fiqh is so important. It's so important for Islamic education. So why these three opinions, why are they important? What were the three opinions?
The Prophet did something that is completely obligatory.
Okay, what's your proof?
Surah Ali Imran, ayah 32.
What's the verse?
I don't have it written down.
Okay. Anyone remember the verse? You write the verse in order to go back and read it and benefit from your last time here. Right? Close.
That's 32.
You've been 32?
Really?
Well, 32. Yeah. 332. Surah Al-Imran 32. Oh, that's one. Atiullah wa Atiur Rasul. Obey Allah and obey his messenger. And there's another verse. وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ. Whatever the Prophet has given you, take it. So the first opinion says, okay, whatever he gives you, basically whatever he does, You take it. And the take here is what? What type of verb is it?
It's a command.
It's a command. And we learned earlier in commands and in prohibitions, right?
Mm-hmm.
That the basis of a command form of a verb insinuates what?
Obligation.
Obligation. So they said here, فَخُضُوا, take. Whatever he does, you take it. It's obligatory. But then there's people of the people of the second opinion, they say, no. مَعْذِرَةً. Excuse me, hold on. That doesn't mean everything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. Right? It means everything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered us to do. What's the proof of that?
Man is free from liability until otherwise stated.
Man is free from liability until otherwise stated. Okay? The people of Qul al-Awwal say it's been stated. Allah says take.
Something about the word take in Arabic is the opposite of prohibit.
You're almost there. Kind of close. Remember I said the obligation doesn't deal with the word take in and of itself when we're talking about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They said, whatever the Prophet gives you, take it. Okay.
That applies to prohibitions.
You're almost there. Allah says, whatever the Prophet gives you, take it. And then He says, whatever He prohibits you from, stay away from. I just gave you the hint.
Right, so all the actions, you know, you can take it, but everything that's prohibited, it's not applying to that.
Because whatever He prohibits, it has to be a statement for Him to make that clear to you, right?
Okay, look. Allah says, whatever the Prophet gives you, take. And then He says, whatever He prohibits you from, stay away from. So we could understand here, the fact that He said prohibits means that the opposite of prohibit is what is insinuated in the beginning of the verse. Whatever the Prophet, what?
Gives
you. What is the murad? What did Allah mean? What did He want to insinuate or imply here with the word atakum?
Whatever He obligates.
Yes. And what's the proof of that? Because later in the verse He says, and whatever He prohibits you from. You see how that was gathered?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So obligation would be a command?
Yes. So they're saying, no, not whatever the Prophet ﷺ does is by default obligation. See, this is important. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ does is by default obligation in actions of ibadah? No. It's not. The Prophet ﷺ prayed Fajr 2 rak'ahs before Fajr. Is that obligatory upon us?
No.
Ya akhi, the Prophet ﷺ, Allah said, whatever He gives you, take. And take is a command form of the verb. Therefore, it's obligatory. Haven't you studied Usul al-Fiq? The Prophet ﷺ, when he went to go make Umrah, he would go and pray. When he went to make Umrah, he would pray behind Maqam Ibrahim. So when you go to make Hajj with your group, and you go and you don't pray behind Maqam Ibrahim, astaghfirullah ya akhi, the wajib. Alaik. It's obligatory. And you say, no, it's not. He says, ya akhi, whatever the Prophet ﷺ has given you, take it. And that's the take is command form. The people of the second opinion would say, no, this take is insinuating obligations. What is meant by take, or what is meant by gives you, is obligations. So whatever the Prophet orders you to do, take it. You understand? That's a very, it's very daqiq, it's very precise in that way that the people of Qulathan and the same Qulathan. The people that had the third opinion, they said what?
Silence.
We're not going to say it's obligatory, nor are we going to say it's mustahab. Right? Because the people of the second opinion say, oh, it's mustahab. Right? It's mustahab meaning what? Recommended. Right? Because when you say wajib, what does that mean? This is very important. When you say something is obligatory, what does that mean? When we learn ahkam taklifiyah, when we learn the rules, wajib means what? What's the definition of it? Yes.
Right.
Yes. You're ordered to do it, and if you leave it, you deserve. Very important that people of the Mutaakhirin, some people say, we don't say you get punished, we say you deserve punishment because that's up to Allah.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So if you don't pray behind Maqam Ibrahim, if you don't you deserve to be punished, or you're liable for punishment. That's why it's so important when we say wajib, you know, we can't just go around just saying it. The early mother passed, we're not like that. So we see the third opinion was that they say, no, we're not going to say it's either wajib or stop. We're going to just say nothing. Why is this the weakest of all three opinions?
If the Prophet did it himself, then it's already implied that...
It's already implied that it's what?
That it's allowed. It's allowed.
You're not allowed.
That it is.
We already understood that it's allowed because he did it. That's it. That it is at least
recommended.
At least recommended. At least. This is an actions of worship now, not actions of customary practices. Okay, and then from this, where do we go off to in contemporary issues that was kind of juicy somewhat? Remember?
Yes.
Dress. Mm-hmm. Right. We got into the issue of dress, right? From the customary practices, is it customary or is it an action of worship? Which category does it fall into? The Prophet praying five times a day, what's that? Customary or action of worship?
Worship.
Is that action of worship obligatory?
Yes.
How do you know?
There's multiple verses confirming that it's an obligatory act.
Okay, and there's multiple hadith. From the strongest of them is what? Pray as you have seen me. And that's it. And pray is what? What type of verb?
Command.
Necessitating what?
Obligation.
This is the process that the usuli goes through. The usuli starts from the usul, the basis, right? The faqih starts from the top. The faqih says prayer is obligatory because this in the verse. Because, of, you see what I'm saying?
We're working from the ground.
We're working from the ground. That's why it's called usul al-fiqh. The roots. Usul means root. Usul is the plural of root. Is the plural of usul. Right?
Yeah, you're saying the what is the word? Fiqh?
Faqih.
Faqih. He looks at an action and then he tries to break down to see whether it's like permissible or whatever. Is that what you're saying?
Well, the faqih, he mainly deals with the actions of the slave. Right? And then he looks into the adillah. So he'll talk about, okay, prayer. What is the ruling of prayer? What is the ruling of so-and-so? What is the ruling of so-and-so? He talks about the af'al al-mukallafin, the actions of the slave, and then gives the rulings based on that, then brings the dalil. Dalil being from the Quran and the Sunnah. But the usuli looks only at the dalil. It's a study of the adillah. You understand what I'm saying? It's the study of the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the study of the sunnah. Being from the aspect of, okay, the sunnah is categorized into what? How does that affect the ruling? You understand what I'm saying?
It's like a constitutional lawyer versus a litigation attorney or something like that. Meaning, one person is dealing specifically with the root. They're looking at the source material. They're trying to come up with...
Yes, exactly.
Then the other person is looking at an action someone's already done.
Yes.
And ruling whether or not it falls within...
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Is one science like superior or the other? Did you say that or not really?
Maybe superior.
I don't know. Like
from whose aspect? The student, the.
It's just a general question.
Well, I mean, some of the scholars say, what should a student of knowledge study first? Is it usul al-fiqh or fiqh?
Yeah.
Right. So some of them differ. Some they say no usul al-fiqh in order to understand. Adillat al-fiqh, to understand the proofs of fiqh, the result, right? And some say, no, it's just to study fiqh, because that's the end result, and then you work backwards, right? So it depends, and you know, as far as Allah alam, for me, if somebody's going to study, really wants to study the deen, become a student of knowledge, and to be independent somewhat, I'd definitely say start with usul al-fiqh, without a doubt. Because that makes you, once you study usul al-fiqh and you just have a general understanding, you will understand, you will have tasted a little of freedom. Do y'all understand what I mean by that?
You can look at a ruling not just at face value.
You're going to ask the educated questions to a sheikh when he brings a fatwa. And when he hears you ask those questions, he knows you have a similar... Just like when you talk to anyone in a certain field and you use certain jargon. Okay, he must have some certain background in this. Same thing with Usul al-Fiq. Right? If you go to a sheikh and you say, okay, is that am or is that khas? Is that generalized or it had the mansukh? Is that abrogated? But I thought this was abrogated. Is that mutlaq or muqayyad? Is that an absolute or is it not? Right? You ask those kinds of questions. But this verse, if it's obligatory, but this is not a command verb in the verse, so how is it made obligatory? Right? This is sunnah, but is this sunnah wajibah? Is it wajib? Well, where in the proof of his sunnah wajib? Was this action of the Prophet an action of ibadah? Then how can we say that it was... No, it wasn't an action of ibadah. Then how can we say it was... Somebody comes to you and says, okay, wearing the imamah, akhi, wearing the imamah is wajib. You say, the Prophet ﷺ did it. All the time. Right? First thing we ask him is, what's your delil that the Prophet ﷺ did it all the time? If there comes that the Prophet ﷺ used to always wear his imamah. Okay, does that necessitate obligation upon every Muslim man that they should wear the imamah all the time? That they should wear the imamah all the time? Obviously, not. The next question is it recommended for the Muslim to wear it? This is where you have to ask, is this issue, does it fall into
worship
or
customary?
Yes.
Where is the delil behind it?
Where's the delil behind what?
To say that it's one of the... I think we talked
induction.
About
yeah. Okay. Induction. Like
what's
through
the purpose of it to get you closer to Allah, if so then.
Right. Is wearing it, and that's what we talked about the last time where we talked about okay, someone wearing kuhl, right? I think you know, certain things that the Prophet ﷺ did of his actions, okay, is it recommended? Is it mustahab? Will it get you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now, one thing I didn't mention before, because I didn't want it to insinuate that if someone does it, then it's worthless, or he will not receive reward for it. No. If someone does an action that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that has been authentically preserved, that he has done it, he has worn this, he has worn that, if they're doing it simply to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of their love, inshallah they'll receive reward for that. But if they do it thinking that it is sunnah mustahabba, that it is a recommended practice, that's where it's different. See, there's a difference between you doing something that you know the Prophet did and you're doing it for yourself. And between that and doing something for yourself and telling other people to do it, it's a big difference. Because you're speaking on behalf of the deen when you do that. It's a huge difference. That's why it's not recommended, especially a lot of times you find, I don't want to say the youth, but you find people that they'll start to learn their deen or they'll start to come upon a contemporary issue, right, that's going on with the Muslims, or a contemporary issue that a lot of Muslims are asleep upon and they want to address it, and the person doesn't have basic knowledge. They're not well grounded in the knowledge. It's an issue of difference of opinion, and they go on the minbar and talk about it. This is a huge mistake. If you're going to talk about issues that have difference of opinion, whether it's from the scholars of the past or scholars that are contemporary scholars, you better talk about it with concise words that show that you understand that there's difference of opinion and you're bringing some of the benefits of the opinion that you may hold, but at the same time, you're not pushing them and making it binding upon the listeners. And that's why you notice a lot of times the scholars, they don't, especially on the minbar, because the minbar is the hugest form of marketing in Islam. Hugest. Because you're going to get people that don't come to the masjid, people that don't pray, etc., coming at that day. And then you're going to talk about an issue that is different to opinion. Not wise.
You should tell some of
them. Huh?
You should tell some of the people on the list.
No, there's many people, I think. Talk about basic issues. I always tell people if they're going to start giving khutbah, just go into Riyadh al-Salihin. That's it. You go into the first, especially the first chapter, the first book, the first couple of chapters. These are all issues that deal with the heart, all issues that warn the slave of so on and so forth. Instead of talking about contemporary issues. Okay, so that's generally what we covered on the sunnah. So today we're going to cover abrogation.
I think it's called supersession.
In the notes.
Supersession.
Huh. The poem?
They call it supersession.
Yeah, that's why I couldn't find it last week, because it's called statements or something.
Yeah.
Chapters concerning statements.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. This chapter of Nusr is very important. There are certain wisdom behind it, and we're going to briefly go over that. But it's an essential aspect of a student of knowledge to know this, to firstly accept it and to understand its implications. Because if not, this is kind of how you find certain people, certain sects, they didn't know that a certain verse was abrogated or not. Someone may be practicing something that was abrogated and didn't realize it. Okay. So firstly, the first issue is the definition. Can someone read the definition?
The abrogation of an earlier address hukum with another.
Okay. So we're going to kind of go word by word, because each word has been chosen over others due to certain implications. So we didn't say replacement, because replacement leaves room for a temporary term of the action. So if someone replaces someone for us, like a substitute teacher, they are replacing them. So there is a possibility of the person coming back. Replacement does not necessitate relinquishment of that which was replaced. It's a possibility, but it does not necessitate that. Does everyone understand? Right. That's enough. This also insinuates that the purpose of the earlier address, hukum, was continuation. So when we say abrogation of something, right, that means the ruling that was abrogated, the intent of it was to stay, be continuous until something else comes. The original rule that was abrogated was never meant to be temporary. Does everyone understand that? It was never meant to be temporary. It was meant to stay upon that ruling until the end of time. Also, the permissibility of buying and selling after Jummah prayer does not abrogate the impermissibility of transactions after the second adhan of Jummah. Everybody knows that after the second adhan of Jummah, it's impermissible to
buy
or sell. Anyone know the proof?
What's
the ayah? فَسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ. Right? يَا يُوَذِينَ أَمْنُوا. If you were called to prayer, إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ. If there was a call to the prayer, for people to be called to prayer, يوم الجمعة, فَسْعَوْا. So the first thing he says, what? مِنْ سَعِي. What does سَعِي mean? Like
run.
To rush. Rush. So that's an amr. That's an obligation. Then he says, فَسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ. ذَرُوا means leave. That's another obligation. Right? So leave off bayr, buying and selling. Okay? What was the ruling? So what's the ruling before the second adhan?
It's completely fine if you want to.
It's fine. Okay? But at this time, this specific time of dhikrillah, it's impermissible, okay? So that's what is meant by it. This also insinuates the purpose of the earlier address, hukum, was continuation. Okay? What is being abrogated has to be an established address, hukum, text from the Quran or Sunnah. Ijma' and qiyas, basically, what is ijma'?
Consensus.
And qiyas is what?
Analogy,
right? Do not qualify. It can also be something that was practiced before that was not addressed to establish law. So, for example, drinking liquor was done at the beginning of Islam, beginning stages of Islam. Okay, the latter address of prohibition came. That prohibition, the latter address of prohibition coming, is not considered what? Abrogation. Allah never ordered people to drink liquor. The drinking of liquor was never an established rule in Islam. It was what was practiced before the coming of the Sharia. I want to say before the coming of Islam, before the coming of Islamic law. Right? So Allah, concerning this matter, initially prohibited it. Right? So that's not considered what?
Abrogation.
Because we didn't abrogate any other ruling. It was an establishment of law at that time. A law was established, and the law was prohibition. The law was prohibition. Does everyone understand that?
Yes.
Now, why can ijma or qiyas not qualify?
This was after the Prophet's time.
Okay, it was after the Prophet's time. Why is the Prophet's time important here? Why is the time frame that it can only be in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, why is that crucial to understand abrogation?
To know when is the gates of ijtihad open or closed? And
what do you mean?
Like, for example, if it's been established in tradition, a certain ruling, and it didn't come from the Quran or the Sunnah, then, you know, that's, then I think the scholar has the right to do ijtihad on that matter if he can, I guess what I'm trying to say is like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, like, this deen has been perfected for you, or something like that, that whatever's in the text, that can't be,
Yes.
I mean, is that is when the deen was still being revealed?
Okay, during the time of
the Prophet.
Okay.
So that kind of can, I guess, you can have abrogations, but after that it doesn't make any sense because the thing cannot be changed.
You need a ruling to abrogate another ruling, like a hukum.
Yeah.
Okay. And the hukum
can only be established by the Prophet. So in the Quran and Sunnah.
Okay, right. The hukum can only be established.
Yeah.
Okay?
Ijma and qiyas can't happen without Quran and Sunnah.
Right.
They don't exist on their own as sources, but Quran and Sunnah on their own are sources.
Okay. Exactly. So ijma and qiyas happened after the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, most of them.
Yeah.
Right? And also they cannot take place except with the Quran and the Sunnah. And another reason is that some of the scholars say that nothing as a weaker source can override or abrogate or relinquish a stronger source. Okay? A stronger source.
In this case, are the Quran and Sunnah at equal level? Will the Sunnah abrogate? Go ahead.
And that's what we're going to talk about, inshallah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's a very good question. We're going to talk about that, inshallah.
Okay.
We're talking about inshallah. Thanks. So everyone understands this. Okay? So the only thing that can abrogate one another is Quran or Sunnah. Ijma' cannot abrogate an ayah or a hadith. Or qiyas cannot abrogate an ayah or a hadith. Okay. So in the definition, we said an earlier address. Okay? That's another condition of abrogation, that whatever is abrogated has to be something that was earlier than the abrogator. Drinking, well, that's not considered nasr. There has to be a time frame between the abrogated and the abrogator. Therefore, the concept of takhsis Remember we took tafsis? This is where the review comes in. This is where it's all connecting. The issue of tafsis in the form of exception and description is not considered due to the fact that it was in the same breath or same time. So what's an example of tafsis? Who remembers tafsis?
I remember, but I can't think of an example.
There was one, there was this verse that always, you can always start with this one. I mentioned it like a million times in the last, in the lesson of tafsis. Exception. Were there any exceptions in the Quran? Yeah. Which is what? Right? So that was tafsis because it's mentioned in the same breath, in the same, right? It wasn't later, there wasn't a ruling established, and then later something came to abrogate that. It was totally contradictory of it. In contradiction to what was mentioned. You understand what I'm saying? And that's a condition of abrogation. That two proofs in the Quran or the Sunnah obviously show contradiction. Why is that so important to understand? Because Orientalists will come to you and say, there's contradiction in your evidences. And many of them do not have they haven't studied Islam formally. So they have no concept of Usul al-Fiq. The average person will be confused because they won't know the proper questions to come back at them with. Are you sure this is not abrogated? Right? Also, someone may come and say, Why is there abrogation? Isn't the Quran revealed? Why would Allah say something and then would it change his mind? Okay. There's so many ways, especially from Usul-al-Fiqh, that an Orientalist can come at you in. Okay? So here, it has to be an earlier address. So basically, a ruling that was well established is there. Then later, another ruling comes. Okay? And there are examples we're talking about. From them is like fasting, the month of Ramadan. The prayer from being, how many times? Two to five, right? Second issue. So that was some important points dealing with the definition, why those certain words were chosen, why the word abrogation as opposed to replacement, and why we said earlier, and why we said it has to be a hukum, because we take out the fact of human intellect, which is ijma' or qiyas. We take out the aspect of temporary abrogation. That's why we said abrogation as opposed to replacement, right? And that's the issue with jumar. And also we took out the fact that it was that it's an earlier, that it has to be something that comes after an established ruling. Because if we don't, then that falls into tukhsis. It falls into specification. Like when we mentioned freeing the slave, when we said tafsis, remember? Mm-hmm. Right? That was actually mutlaq and muqayyid. That was actually absolute. You see, that's where it's very important to understand the concepts, to where when you go on to later chapters, you'll know how to tie them all in. Okay, so issue number two, the abrogation from the aspect of the abrogated, three scenarios. In this chapter of abrogation, they come from many different angles, many different categories. But it's all leading to generally the same thing. But they want you to understand, okay? So first they say that from the aspect of that which is abrogated. So the first example is either the word or the text without the ruling. So the word or the text is abrogated, but the ruling is not, okay? So there was a verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned concerning the stoning of the adulterer in the chapter of Al-Ahzab. That wasn't the chapter of Al-Ahzab, okay? Where it says the sheikh and the sheikha, if they were to perform adultery, then stone them forever as a punishment of Allah. This verse is not in the Quran. But the stoning of the adulterer is still valid. How do we know that? Because it's not here, but there's an author on Umar ibn al-Khattab that he used to do it, and that he's seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do it. Okay? So that was there, and the ruling is still established. Now the question can be raised is, which I don't know, why the verse was taken out.
What happened? I don't understand.
Stoning. The issue of stoning the adulterer. In Islam, if someone commits adultery, what's the ruling?
Stoning.
Yeah. Okay. This verse was taken out. And even though there's other verses, but I mean this verse here, there was a verse here in Surah Al-Ahzab, but it's not, this verse is not present in the Quran.
So what is that? Why is that considered a verse? What does that mean?
It was considered a verse.
Who considered it?
The Sahaba.
Until it no longer was.
But the question of why it no longer was and why it was taken out, below.
It was revelation.
Yeah. Considered revelation. Oh,
I never heard of that.
Because it's not present in the Quran. Yeah. So even though this verse is not present, the ruling remains. The ruling remains. So that's the first type of abrogation when looking at the abrogated, that which was taken away. The second is the ruling without the text.
Text like from the Quran only?
Yeah. Or no, Quran or the Sunnah.
And the Sunnah.
Quran or the Sunnah. So Allah says in the Quran, O you who have believed, when you wish to privately consult the messenger, present before your consultation a charity. If people wanted to come and ask the Prophet something, ask for it, they should give a charity to him in the beginning, the stages of Islam. That is better for you and purer. But if you find not the means, then Allah is indeed the forgiving, the merciful. Okay? So that was a ruling in the beginning. This was later abrogated by أَشْرَكُتُمْ أَن تُقَدْمُوا بَيْنِ يَدَيْنَ جُوَاكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have you feared to present before your consultation charities? Then when you do not, and Allah has forgiven you, then at least establish the prayer and give zakat, and obey Allah and His Messenger, and Allah is well acquainted with what you do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abrogated that with what? So we see here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, have you feared to present before your consultation charities? Then Allah, then when you do not, and Allah has forgiven you. So if you don't, it's not a
sin. So that's considered abrogation. Was that first example considered abrogation?
These are all types of abrogation when it comes to that which was abrogated, yeah.
But the ruling still applied in the first situation, even though...
Yeah.
So why is that considered abrogation if the ruling is still the same?
Because the verse is not there.
But it's like... Kind of
the
weird,
ruling was
like,
backed up by the hadith, right?
Yeah, you're saying the ruling is still the same.
Yeah, so why is that considered abrogation?
That's a good question. Let me review that.
Okay. Yeah, I was just
because
kidding.
No, because if it was abrogation, then it would be that they wouldn't be stoned because it would take away the earlier ruling, which is stoning. I think it's that the sheikh and the sheikha. Let me review that.
Could it be that the earlier ruling was in Surah An-Nisa where Allah condemns the adulterer to spend, basically the ruling was that they stay at home basically until Allah reveals a ruling basically about their faith. That was
no.
The punishment for adultery before rajm was revealed.
No.
Is that correct? Or?
Yeah, that's correct. But in this category, let me make sure.
Right.
You're right. Uh-huh. Just that I'm missing something that's very obvious. I don't know why. Yeah, I'm missing something. Something I'm missing. But I'm going to review that, inshallah. So we have the third category. This is another example for the second category. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and those of you who die and leave behind wives should bequeath for their wives a year's maintenance and residence without turning them away. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that the one that's a widow, that their iddah, their waiting period for the deceased one is what?
One year.
So in Allah, this verse mentions that the waiting period for a widow woman is one whole year, but this was abrogated by the verse. Allah says, and those of you who die and leave wives behind them, they shall wait four months and 10 days. So the earlier ruling was a year, then after that it was 4 months and 10 days. Okay. Now the ruling and the
text.
Aisha radiallahu anha, she mentioned that it was mentioned in the Quran that 10 suckling cycles would make the nursing mother impermissible to marry. Then it was abrogated to 5. It was abrogated to 5. We're going to cover this a little more in depth when we move on, inshallah, just to get the categorization. So issue number 3 is abrogation from the aspect of the type of abrogation. So the first thing we talked about was that which was abrogated, okay, that which was taken away, okay, whether it's the ruling without the text, or the text without the ruling, or both of them. Okay, so now we're talking about the abrogation from the aspect of the type of abrogation, the 3 types. So the first one is the abrogation without a replacement. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may remove a hukum and not bring a replacement for it. Okay, because you got to understand, nasr in English means abrogate, but what nasr linguistically means is to move something somewhere, or to eliminate. Okay, so here we're eliminating something and we're not replacing it. So the previous verses mentioned being that charity was abrogated without a replacement. Because remember that the charity was abrogated when you wanted to ask the Prophet ﷺ for something, to give charity. But then Allah said that you don't have to give charity, and Allah is forgiving most much. Did He replace it with something else?
No.
Not really, right? That's why some of the scholars mentioned that the replacement in order was to establish the prayer and the zakat. That's like the charity that you give to the good that you... That's what some of them mentioned when they saw in the verse. Y'all remember the verse? You can go back to it. See, this was to privately consult the messenger and present before your consultation a charity, right? This is a what?
Command.
What's the ruling?
To present charity.
And what kind of verb is this?
It's a command.
It's a command, necessitating what?
Obligation.
Necessitating obligation. Then after that, O you who have faith, present before your consultation of charities. Have you feared أَجْرُكُمْ أَنْ تُقَدْمُ بَيْنَ يَدَيْنَ الْوَاحِمُ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَتَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. Then, when you do not, and Allah has forgiven you, because He didn't attribute to this a what? If you don't do the charity, even though He ordered you here, He didn't what?
Command something else.
He didn't assign to this lack of giving charity a punishment. Rather, He said what? Allah has forgiven you, which insinuates that the ruling of obligation has been abrogated. Right? It's done. Has He replaced it with something? Like how He's replaced the 2 prayers to 5? How He replaced praying to the praying to Bayt al-Maqdis to praying to the Kaaba? No. Some of the scholars say, no, He did. Because He says, and establish the prayer and give zakat and obey Allah and His Messenger. So some of them say, no, the replacement is this. Right? Is there one? Yes.
But then that word, at least, it just makes it sound like it's not a command. I don't know.
In the first verse?
In the parentheses, it says, like, then at least establish prayer.
The parentheses, yeah. I mean, that's what's insinuated, right, to where it could be understood that, okay, that the fact, but at least is actually interpreted from the people that translated the book. Yeah, but yeah, it could be understood as that, well, at least due to the understanding of the whole situation, that does insinuate recommendation. But obviously we know that prayer and what? Giving zakat. Was it obligatory? Now the question is, during the time of the revelation of this verse, was it obligatory? Which probably is a reason why the person that translated, if they have knowledge of that, they put that. That's why translations of the Quran is so important also, because it can lead you to understanding the Quran a certain way. So we left off at right here. Now, the second type of abrogation or scenarios is a rougher replacement. It may demand more effort. So for an example, the fasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that fasting is for a limited number of days. So whoever among you is ill or on a journey, then an equal number of days. And upon those who are able to fast, or to fast but with hardship, a ransom or feeding the poor of each day. Poor person, whoever volunteers in excess is better for him. But to fast is best for you, if you but knew. What do we understand from this verse, the ruling?
Fasting is obligatory.
Where do we see that it's obligatory in here? I shouldn't have chosen this translation in parentheses.
Yeah, before it. It's the obligation, yeah.
Right here, in this verse.
Oh, this one.
So whoever amongst you is ill and on a journey, then an equal number of days to be made up. And upon those who are able to fast, but with hardship, a ransom, a substitute of feeding the poor for each person. And whoever volunteers excess is better for him. But to?
Fast.
What does that insinuate? It's recommended.
Okay.
Doesn't show obligation.
Okay. You're right.
Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Shahru Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran, a guidance, and it's for people to clear proofs of guidance and criterion. So whoever cites the new moon of the month, فَلْيَسُمْ. That is where the scholars have extracted that this is where it shows that it's obligatory. Then let him fast, which basically means then he has to fast it. In Arabic, it's much more clear. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَسُمَ. And even the scholars say, whoever cites, they attributed the obligation to an action of the slave, which was seeing. And that's where the whole difference of opinion comes in. Of seeing the moon with the eyes or not. Along with other proofs, because the Prophet ﷺ said we are an illiterate nation, we don't read or write. Right? Yes, did you have a question? Yes.
In the previous verse, if it was just obligatory, if it was just a
recommendation.
It was just a recommendation, then you wouldn't have, like, Allah subhanahu wa wouldn't have put conditions, like, for those who are not able to fast, then do this and do this. But that doesn't that kind of imply that it is a command?
It could. But see, here it says, for instance, said, so whoever amongst you is ill or on a journey during those days could be made up. And he says, and upon those who are able to fast with hardship, a ransom, as substitute of feeding the poor person each day. And whoever volunteers, then it is better for him. So here it mentions these situations here, if they want to. All of this is to encourage the good, for lack of better words. So if you're not able to, then you can do this. If you're from those people that are ill, then you can do this. And if you're amongst those people who are able to fast, you can do this. Right? But here, the strongest proof is where he mentions, and whoever volunteers in excess, it is better for him. But to fast is better for you if you but do. Understanding what you're saying here, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions these, that's where the scholars say that this is like a partial abrogation. Because here, these rulings still apply after the obligation. Right? Because this here, it doesn't abrogate these here. The fact that if you're ill on a journey, then make up the days, right? Or if you are a person that is able to fast with hardship, you know, then substitute in feeding the poor. But when it comes to the obligation of fasting for 30 days, right? But your question is very, very valid question, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the substituting here. Is that why would that substitute something that is recommended?
Yeah, it's kind of...
You understand what you're saying? So then let me review that one also.
So she's saying it's recommended to fast.
No.
What I mean is, if you're sick, it's recommended to fast, then to do those three actions.
No, I think it's saying that.
The act of fasting in Islam at that time during the revelation of that verse was not obligatory. If you wanted to, it was good for you. It was good to do so. But if you didn't, then you could do these other things. But you had to give something. Right? But it wasn't that you had to fast. You understand? That you had to fast for 30 days. Right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions here that whoever sees the moon, then let him fast. And whoever is ill on a journey, then the same situation that was mentioned before. Right? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to abrogation, moves to a lighter replacement. There's another scenario where it's a lighter replacement. An example is where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, O Prophet, urge the believers to fight. If there are 20 steadfast persons among you, they will overcome 200. And if there be 100 steadfast persons, they will overcome 1,000 of those who disbelieve. Because they disbelievers are the people who do not understand. So the responsibility here is what? To fight. If there are 20, they will overcome. And if there are 100 steadfastness, they will overcome. Right, so 20 to 200, and 100 to?
1 to 10.
1 to 10, yeah, basically. That was replaced with, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-ana khafafa Allahu ankum wa alima annak fikum da'fa. Allah knows, has lightened your task, and He knows that there is weakness in you. So if there are of you 100 steadfast persons, they shall overcome 200. And if there are 1,000, they should overcome 2,000. Right? And another proof that we know that this is has come after, because now it says, now Allah has lightened your task. So we know that it's definitely become after that. And the reason He's done that is because He knows that there is weakness in you. And that's a small benefit from that with nasr, especially when dealing with converts or dealing with people that are new to Islam, that you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the reasons why He abrogates a ruling is because He wants to make it easy on the people that were new to the faith. So when Islam first came, they were drinking. He didn't prohibit it in the beginning. There was what is called tadarruj, right? Even in the chapter of Nahl, he acknowledged the fact that when he was mentioning the beauty of what he provides his slaves, he mentioned that there is grapes, the grapes that you drink with. Right? So he acknowledged the drink. He didn't prohibit it at that time. Even later when he talks about the salah. Oh, you believe? Do not come to the prayer and you are
intoxicated.
Did he prohibit it then? No. But then later in Islamic history, he says what? Verily gambling and khamr, right? Is impermissible. Or it's najis, rijis. Fajtanibu. Then he gives a ruling. So stay away from it. Perhaps you will be successful. So when we see nasr, there is a wisdom behind it. That Allah is being gradual with the progression of the slave. And that's why we know that Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, if we were ordered to stay away from riba and drinking, we would have, what? We would have left Islam.
Yeah.
That's what a companion is saying. Right, Aisha? We would have left Islam. So that is one of the wisdoms behind the whole concept of abrogation.
Can I ask you, like, what is the fiqh behind these verses? I mean, like, what's the ruling that you get from these?
That you have to go and fight if there are at that number. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned if they're at a number that is at that fraction, then that obligation wouldn't apply to them.
Okay. You can't run away from the battlefield.
Yeah, but you can't run away, right, from the
battlefield. It's less than 1 to 2.
Exactly.
Oh, but you're saying that if it was less, like when that second verse came down, that it was permissible to like leave the battlefield if those numbers are not there? Is that what you're saying?
Now you're talking about offensive and defensive. If they were to come and battle you,
yeah.
Right?
Right.
Right. If they're to come into your...
Oh, good.
Yeah.
I see what
you're saying. Okay. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. The fourth issue is abrogation from the aspect of the abrogator. The first one was of the abrogated, the one that was being relinquished or taken away. So obviously the first type is the Quran with the Quran. And we talked about that earlier. So you have, you know, the issue of fasting, the issue of
this one.
The one before it. It's the Quran, Yansif Quran is abrogating another verse in the Quran. Type the Sunnah abrogating a verse in the Quran. You see, the issue of facing the Qibla wasn't always where the Muslims used to face when they pray. Where was it to in the beginning?
Jerusalem.
Bayt al-Maqdis, right? In Jerusalem, right? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, verily we have seen the turning of your face towards the heaven. Surely we shall turn you to a Qibla. The prayer direction that shall please you. So turn your face to the direction of Masjid al-Haram. And wheresoever you people are, turn your faces in that direction. So Allah ordered the prayer to the Kaaba. Before it was to Bayt al-Maqdis. And the proof of Bayt al-Maqdis is in other establishments. Another example is the returning of any Muslim that made Hijrah after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. From the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, there was a Muslim, it was a treaty that the Prophet ﷺ made with the
Quraysh.
Quraysh, right. For the purpose of what?
Safe passage. Or, yeah, safety, really.
Safety, right? Yeah. To where there could be?
Commerce. trade between the two.
Commerce and harmony amongst them.
Mm-hmm.
And this is very important nowadays. Right? Very important nowadays. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, oh, you believe, when believing women come to you as immigrants, examine them. Allah knows best as to their faith. Then if you ascertain that they are true believers, send them not back to the disbelievers. Because before, if they were in Mecca, after the treaty was established, right? From the articles of the treaty is that if someone came from Mecca, a Muslim, and they came and they escaped from Mecca and came to Medina, the Prophet had to do what? He had to send them back. Right? But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought this ruling down. Why? Allah knows best. At that time, he saw due to his knowledge that it was more beneficial for the iman of the people and more beneficial for the deen in general.
That right. Ruling specifically existed within the treaty, not outside of it.
The ruling
like, like that ruling of the Prophet having to turn away people,
yes,
that was written in the treaty, but there were no hadith basically mentioning it. It's just from the text of the treaty.
For the, yeah, exactly.
So do we consider that text sunnah as well? Or like...
No, no, because that's not something that is an established ruling for all Muslims.
Okay. It's just a historical document.
It's, a historical document that general text of the Quran and sunnah obviously fall into it.
Okay.
Right? Which is so, which is basically looking at the general benefits and the harms.
Okay.
Right? Like when the Prophet, when he wrote in the surah, he said, they told him, Bismillah, he wrote Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and they said, we don't know ar-Rahman. And he wanted him to erase it. And Ali was upset. He's like, you're gonna erase. You know, and even when he said he's the messenger of Allah, right? They wanted him to erase it. And he erased it, but some of the companions were like, you are the messenger of Allah. But he looked at the general, bit the public interest, right? So that's a general sunnah also. That's what I'm talking about. Looking at the public interest is a sunnah in and of itself.
So you may not take it itself, but you take the meta, you take the lesson, the...
Exactly. Okay. And every single proof in Islam, and this is what we're talking about, maqasid.
Yeah.
That's what branches off from usul. Every single proof in Islam either has a benefit or a harm that, a benefit that outweighs the harm, or a harm that outweighs the benefit. And you'll find when you talk about Islamic law and Islamic, the objectives of Islamic law, every single ruling has a harm and a benefit. So when we talk about smoking, for instance, there's a benefit, but the harm outweighs the benefit. Drinking liquor, there's a benefit, but the harm outweighs the benefit, right? Now that benefit may not be something that is beneficial for your deen.
Body or whatever.
Yeah. Or maybe for your nafs, your desire. Right? But the harm outweighs that. Understood? And that's why Ibn Qayyim subhanAllah made a beautiful point. He said that's why heaven and hell is the only pure benefit. There is nothing harmful in heaven. Pure bliss. And hell is totally opposite. I read that, I just, wow.
Can you say it in Arabic?
That's why Jannah, what did he say? Jannah, the word he used is Na'imun Tam, Waladhatun Tam, and Jahannam Fihi Dar Tam. It's just complete harm and it's just complete. What's the word in English? Can't remember the word in English. There's no benefits in Jahannam. It's totally harmful. There's nothing that is beneficial for the slave in Jahannam. But in Jannah, it's the total opposite. And that is why the slave in the dunya is called mukallaf. He's called mukallaf means that the burden of response, I don't want to say burden, but it's you're responsible for what you do in this life. And they say mukallaf, meaning that it may be stressful at times to do those acts. Waking up and praying Fajr, right? There may be some harm in doing that, but the benefit outweighs the harm. Getting married, as opposed to going out and dating, right? The benefit of that outweighs the harm. Dating, as opposed to getting married, the harm outweighs the benefit. Riba. We see nowadays there's an apparent benefit, right? But the harm outweighs the, even non-Muslims attest to that.
Mm-hmm.
So that, when we see rulings, that's why it's so important to understand this. See, when you, again, studying Usul al-Fiqh, it brings that to life. And then when you study Maqasid al-Sharia, it brings that to life. Because when people come to you and they say, but this person didn't face this problem that you're saying. That doesn't change the ruling at all. That doesn't change the fabric, the integrity of the rule. Right? And there's another general principle that you see the scholars say, "Anadira la hukma lahu." The rarities do not take a general ruling. If something is rare, that doesn't mean that we should change the whole ruling for it. Right?
Just because one person's exception, you don't give that to everybody.
Right. And you'll find people say that with the issue of, like, sometimes when they talk about the issue of the mahram. Right? You find some scholars say, well, yeah, okay, but this one, she wasn't harmed when she traveled and so on and so forth. We say that, okay, but that doesn't change the ruling with the Prophet himself. Mm-hmm.
So this, would this be considered example of number two on the previous slide?
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, we're almost done.
Type the third is the sunnah with the sunnah. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves, now visit them for they remind you of the hereafter. Where is the abrogation in here?
The prohibition of visiting graves is abrogated.
By?
Allowance of visiting graves.
Okay, but this is in the same breath. Why is this not takhsis?
Because he's referring to a previous time where he said, don't go to the graves.
Yeah. Right. And also, right, okay, true. But also a takhsis, does what was specified negate the ruling of the generality?
No.
Not necessarily.
No.
No.
Well, asr. Innal. Right? Everybody's at loss. Except, which is one of the signs of what?
Specification.
Except the ones who believe and do righteous deeds. So does that mean that everyone is going to believe and do righteous deeds?
Not necessarily, no.
Nope.
Right? Does that mean that everyone is not at a loss? No, there will still be people at a loss.
Yeah.
But at the same time, there is an exception. Abrogation, nasakh, removes the ruling of what was previously mentioned. So here, the prohibition of going to the graves has been abrogated. Right? Visit them, and then he even gives you the wisdom behind it here. For verily they remind you of thee hereafter. They remind you of thee hereafter. And the last portion is the Quran with the Sunnah. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions here, it is prescribed for you that when death approaches you, if he leaves wealth, then make a bequest to the parents and next of kin according to the reasonable manners. This is a duty upon the muttaqun. This was later abrogated by the Prophet ﷺ in a hadith saying, verily Allah has given everything its due right, so therefore there is no bequest to legal heirs. Okay. Some of the scholars mentioned that this is not a valid type of abrogation.
Okay.
Why do you think they say that?
There's an ayah that specifies who gets what in terms of inheritance.
Yeah.
That's the basis for inheritance law.
The sunnah. Right. And now mind you, I should have put here that this is Quran with sunnah that is not mutawatir.
Okay.
Some scholars say, no, sunnah does not Quran. But if the sunnah is ahad, if it's not mutawatir, because there's different categories, there's ahad and there's hasan, right? If it is not mutawatir, then the sunnah does not replace, cannot abrogate a verse in the Quran.
It needs to be the highest of the high hadith to do that, right?
The highest level of hadith which is mutawatir. Okay. Everybody understand what mutawatir is?
Multiple chains of narration.
Now, what is the benefit of the differentiation between multiple chains of narration and non-multiple, where it's, you know, 10 or less, or, you know, whatever number some of the scholars designated to? Because if it's multiple chains of narration, that you feed it implies what?
Authenticity.
Not authenticity, but
acceptance.
A level of
validity,
but
security.
Because of what?
It was reported. So,
preached it. It wasn't just something that happened.
Remember last week when I mentioned if somebody walks into class and I said only one person told me? Remember last week I mentioned that?
Yeah. Now it's all on that person's character, if that's the case, right?
No.
Ask your question again, I'm sorry.
Okay, let me. If somebody, if I also say, you know what? If I also say, okay, what did the first thing that came to my mind? I couldn't believe it when I saw it, actually. Donald Trump, what he called Rubio. He called one of the presidents, not Rubio, but
Cruz.
Somebody blurted something in the audience, and he repeated what that person blurted. Did y'all see that?
Yeah. He said, I didn't say it.
Oh, it's doubtful. That's weird. How can you have that person as a president of the United States?
I didn't say it. I don't advocate it.
Because they asked Marco Rubio about the type of torture. I forgot the name of it.
Waterboarding.
Yeah. And he didn't say, I totally believe in it. He made some exceptions, and then he basically, as far as the far rightist people, he danced around the issue. So then when they asked Trump about it, you know, Trump, he was going to have a field day. So he was like, I'm surprised he didn't just say, you know, that, you know, it is something that we should practice, don't it? So somebody said something in the audience, and they said, because he's a profane body part. I'll just say that. So Donald Trump took advantage of the situation. He was like, now, what you said, you shouldn't say that. Don't say that. Right? And then he said, now, I'm going to say what she said, but I didn't say it.
Yeah.
And then he said what she said. And that crowd went crazy. They went wild. She said he's a... And I said, oh, stop. Now, if one person walked in the room and they said, you know what, you hear what Donald Trump said the other day? I said, no, what did he say? I think he said that Marco Rubio was a, right? And then I asked everybody else and they're like, no, I don't remember. I don't remember saying that. That's like ahad, right? Somewhat. But if everybody came in here and said, yeah, he said so-and-so. That's kind of like mutawatir. So the level of...
context. It provides more context, right?
Importance.
It begins with the C and ends with the Y.
Clarity?
Not clarity.
Consensus.
Consensus.
That doesn't know the Y.
Consistency.
Continuity. Keep going.
Certainty.
Okay. It removes any doubt.
I remember this example.
Really? Now you remember the example?
Yeah.
Personal was on 59.
Yeah.
I remember this.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
You were
right. That was the example I gave.
What did
that
say?
You weren't there.
That was the example I gave.
Oh, okay.
The level of certainty, if there's five different chains, and in each chain is five people, and each person is, mashallah, their grade of reliability is high. That's the level of certainty that this hadith is authentic. But if there's only one chain, right, or two chains, and each person in the chain is
good,
right, it still leaves a level of doubt that hadith is as is, right? And that's why the Hanafiya would not take, you couldn't make, in issues of aqidah, they wouldn't use hadith that are ahad. Because in aqidah we have to be what?
Solid.
Certain.
We can't leave any room for
doubt.
Right? But then you find the people of hadith and the jumhur, they'll say, no, if it's hadith ahad, it's still you feed al-ilm. It still benefits certainty. Why is this important? Because the ones that say no, a hadith that is ahad, that is a solitary, they call it a solitary hadith, it still can abrogate a verse in the Quran.
Yeah.
Why do you think they say that?
Because the Prophet ﷺ used ahad. There are examples of ahadith in the Sunnah. Like the Prophet sending a single messenger to deliver a message.
Okay.
That's one narrator narrating a single message. And, you know.
Okay, but those are companions.
Are you saying that it has to
be a chain that comes from the companion?
No. If it was something that was removing from the Quran, Allah SWT has promised to protect the Quran.
That's a general way of thinking,
yeah.
Right?
Your question is
he can protect the Quran by me having the opinion that a hadith or ahad or shouldn't be accepted and can't abrogate his word. The manifestation of that is this issue.
Yeah, that's true.
Your question is that the sunnah can abrogate the Quran.
Can a solitary hadith abrogate a verse in the Quran?
You're saying
why can it?
Why do the ones that say that it can, what's one of their proofs? Think about it. An authentic solitary hadith.
Because of the verse in the Quran or whatever the prophet gives you say.
But how do we know that we're not sure that he gave it to us? Because we're not totally sure.
You just said we are. You said it's an authentic hadith.
Right. You're close.
Well, there's still a doubt because it's ahad.
But is it a ruling that has been established in Islam?
Yes.
So we take it and we act on it, right?
Oh,
right.
Okay.
So we take it and we act on it. Why can't it be at the level of abrogating a verse in the Quran? Remember, this is difference of opinion. This, I'm just bringing you the academic argument. Right? So if this hadith ahad, we worship Allah based on this hadith. If the Prophet ﷺ said something that has clear contradiction of a verse, and he is the actualizer of the Quran, if he says something in total contradiction, then it must be, and it came after the verse was revealed, then it must be abrogation. Does everyone understand that? It must be abrogation. Then, again, the Jumhur, the majority of scholars say that this is not a valid categorization. Yes?
And so you're saying like a single chain, but are you saying that it's general knowledge, but the chain is just a matter of it? So, for example, Imam Malik used to take whatever the people of Medina practiced as like proof of the religion, right? So if it's common knowledge, but the hadith is coming from just one chain, are you saying that abrogates?
Yeah.
That table to abrogate?
Right. Some of the scholars will say that it would. Well, if you're saying common, define common knowledge.
As in,
yeah, but common knowledge, that needs to be defined. Is it common knowledge to where it's ijma' of the scholars on that? Mm-hmm. Right? Or is it common knowledge in a certain place where they practice it and there's difference of opinion on that? Mm-hmm. Right? Because common knowledge is that, for instance, hijab issue, right? Niqab or not. It's common knowledge that there's difference of opinion on that, right? There's common knowledge on many issues in Islam that is common knowledge of the difference of opinion. But Imam Malik, for instance, all the scholars did not agree on his opinion. There's difference of opinion on what he considers an established source of law. If the people of Medina did it, then it's considered a law. And the reasoning behind that, it's what they call wajih. It's a valid understanding. I mean, we can understand why he would say that, right? But to establish a ruling in Islam based on people in the Medina, that's what it's called sunnah. So does everyone understand this categorization and why? It's the most important thing is not the categorization, and it just helps you to get a better understanding of the nus. But most importantly is the academic discourse between the scholars. That's the most important thing. Because when you see that, you see how the scholars thought, right? And you realize, man, they're okay. The way that they thought, the process that they went through, and all of this is built on the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not just using their own intellect. And with this, you see the place of the intellect in Islamic education. Right? They wouldn't go beyond the proofs in the Quran and this. They would first look at the proofs in the Quran and the Sunnah and base it upon other proofs in the Quran and the Sunnah. And if there wasn't any of that, then they would go to things like qiyas, etc., etc., etc. Right?
You know, Irshad Manji, she admitted that she Googled the word ijtihad because she didn't know what it meant. Irshad Manji is a well-known, imagine a progressive orientalist, you know, so... She doesn't even know what usul al-fiqh is, you know?
No, bro, I'm telling you, a lot of these people that speak, if someone of education comes to them with a principle in usul al-fiqh, they are lost. They have no idea. None. None whatsoever.
Because you said currently, they don't have taqwa. It's linked together.
Exactly.
They're trained in rhetoric, but they're not trained in Islam.
Exactly. They're trained in...
They lost. They don't have basis for taqwa.
And that's why, subhanAllah, the one that studies usul al-fiqh, and then they study, you know, they understand rhetoric and they understand philosophy. Like, Tariq Ramadan is pretty good.
Yeah.
He's pretty good, you know. Mm-hmm. When he speaks with them, he knows what questions to ask. He knows how to answer also.
Mm-hmm.
And he understands usul, you know, mashallah. So, a lot of times when I hear them talk, it's like, you know. Yeah, they don't. They do not have a basis of Islamic education.
But I think also, you know, one of the things to note is that, you know, this approach, this is a certain way of thinking that the scholars, they train themselves to think like that, to go straight first to the Quran and the Sunnah, go to those principles, and then place the intellect within there. Whereas the audience for a lot of these, like Irshad Majid and so on, they don't think like that, you know, they think the other way around. So she's trying. She's basically feeding toward or catering towards their way of thinking. You know?
Yeah.
Right, and that's the problem. That's why the person, when they debate her, they don't say, "Well, Allah said in the Quran this."
Right.
You know, you're not. You know, it's just like giving dawah to a non-Muslim, and you're telling them, you know, you're putting a responsibility upon them based upon a verse in a book that they don't even believe in. Right, you have to start with universal principles. That's why it's always good to start from aspects of lordship, you know, of you know, actions of God based on if they're an atheist or not, etc., etc., etc. So yeah, again, this science of usul fiqh, mashallah, it's something that, inshallah, we're gonna try to review the previous chapters and try to put it all together, you know, because the next chapter is a real good chapter talking about contradiction of what's the process. When a scholar sees an apparent contradiction of the proofs, what is the process? What are the steps that they go through? And the reason these steps were established was to maintain the integrity of Islamic sources, right? And kind of this was a taste of it right here. You know, mutawatir hadith versus ahad hadith. Why does the mutawatir have authority over the ahad? What is the power of the ahad hadith, right? So, and you see that what we just went through, the academic discourse between, you know, okay, if the ahad is an established form of law, why can't it?
Yeah.
Right. But then the academic aspect of it is, okay, does it really, and this is a big issue of khilaf also, does a solitary hadith, can we be certain that it is established law?
And you said the majority said no.
No, the ahnaf said that in aqidah,
it can
be. It cannot be.
It cannot be.
Because aqidah is built on certainty.
Right.
And if there's only one chain of narration, there's a possibility that
there's doubt.
Mm-hmm. There's a percentage of doubt in there. But if it's mutawatir, no. That's why you'll find scholars say the Quran is mutawatir.
The most
mutawatir. Yeah. But certain verses that, like I think the Sheikh one that I'm going to figure out, I don't think it was mutawatir. Like that everyone read it, you know, that after it was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As it goes back into the science of the Quran and learning the science of revelation and transmission as it was passed down. You know, after it was written by
scribes
being Hafsa, she kept the Quran Hafsa and then she gave it to but how it was passed down after the Quran was written. Compiled from the companions.
So that opinion that an ahad hadith can be used as Islamic legislation, is that majority?
Yeah.
So that being said, that's the evidence to say that, to back up the opinion that it can be used as abrogation, and that's also the majority opinion. It's also majority opinion that an ahad hadith.
No.
No, it's not?
No.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
That's, no.
Why is that? I mean, like, why did the scholars say that
that it can't be used as abrogation?
Because they still say, well, ahad is not as strong as?
As the original Quran? Oh, as the Quran.
As mutawatir.
Yeah, okay, I got you.
Right, ahad is not as strong as
with the mutawatir in terms of.
Right, so the fact that it's ahad, yeah, we establish it as law, but it's not as strong as mutawatir.
Yeah, so it can't be used to abrogate whatever is mutawatir.
And it can't be used to abrogate. Now the question is, are the ones that say that ahad benefits certainty, are they the ones, the same ones that say that it can abrogate? I'm just saying, these are the questions. Because if it's the Jamur, the majority of them say that ahad benefits certainty. So if it benefits certainty, why are you saying that it can't abrogate? Well, we're saying it can't abrogate because, yeah, it benefits certainty, but it's not as strong as mutawatir. Then others will say, well, that doesn't matter. If it benefits certainty, we act on it, then it can abrogate verse in the Quran. That's why certain books like by Ibn Qudama and Ghazali, this kind of argument, they go on. I mean, they just, you have to stop. I remember when I was in the Jamia, I remember when we were studying Roads to Knowledge, that's the book by Ibn Qudama. You have to stop in the middle of the
paragraph.
He'll mention, because what he'll do is he'll mention, okay, the first opinion is this, second opinion is this. Okay? The first opinion differs with the second opinion with this proof. And with that proof, they come with their rule of usul in this. Then the people of the second opinion refute the first opinion with this proof.
It's
back and forth. You have to stop and say, okay, who? Is this the first opinion or the second opinion? I remember I had to make my own key, like code. Like I remember I used to, in my book, wrote it out on a little margin. Like here's the page, and here's the text of the book. I have to put a line like this, and then sometimes right here. And if, because they won't say like, okay, the second opinion's proof is this. No, they'll just say, you know, Ibn Qudama, the way that they write, he'll just say, he'll just come with the statement of the person that's refuting. So I'll put like three lines, that means the deal. I'll put like this, that means the first, the second opinion, you know, third opinion, like that. So I had to make your own codes to stay on track, because if you don't, you'll get lost. And you just see that, just reading that, it's like, their mind is amazing. The way that they just go back and forth and how they, oh man, that book, I don't know how that could be like translated in English and be adequate. That in and of itself is a total piece of work. Like all these little side debates and questions that we have, you'll find Rosa now there, it's mentioned in that. I mean, this you gotta understand this chapter that we're taking, and more extensive encyclopedic books of Usul al-Fiqh, they go in. There's many different things I've left off. And that's the problem when I'm preparing the lesson, because when I start to read it, I go off into the real specific issues, and it's so I love Usul al-Fiqh, so when I read it, it exercises the mind, and you really have to think. It's not just Allah said this, no, it's the possibilities and the understandings of the scholars based on one proof, and based on, while they're still staying within the parameters of preferring the text over, you know. So it's mashallah. It's a beautiful read. Does anyone have any questions or comments? But I'm going to look up those two issues. Yes?
I kind of have a comment. So, abrogations, like, I think the two different schools have different definitions for abrogations. Because I remember one sheikh mentioned that abrogations aren't truly abrogations in Islam. He, for example, gave the proof that, for example, before the penalty for the adulterers would be for the women to confine them into the houses and for the men to basically you know, have them go out.
Yeah, totally.
Right, and afterwards, the penalty was stoning or, you know, lashing, stuff like that. he said that it wasn't truly abrogated, that, you know, confined them and stuff. Mm-hmm. He said that this is used now, for example, for nowadays, where Islam isn't being practiced, and you cannot do stoning, you cannot do that. So, instead of that, if you have, you know, adulterers or something, this is what you do with them now. So it wasn't exactly abrogated. That's what he said. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
No, basically that this scholar held a view that there is no such thing as abrogation in Islam. So the reason that rulings are different is because we look at the context.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a certain context now, you can apply an abrogated ruling, but there is no such thing to this versus that kind of thing. So for example, a context would be that if you have a teenage daughter who is committing adultery, you don't stone her in this day and age, but instead you just confine her into the house. Because that ruling from the Quran is not abrogated, according to him.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's like very problematic.
But you wouldn't, your teenage daughter, if she's not married, you wouldn't stone her, it would be ashes.
That's, I mean,
who's married?
Any of those quote-unquote barbaric.
But how, that's not abrogation of the lashing? That was never abrogated, period. Was it? I guess maybe the confinement still sticks to that principle.
Well, that's, I'm just saying
with
the scholar.
No, I understand his principle. I mean, that's where you have to go back to, like she mentioned, the definition of, do all the scholars accept abrogation
right.
as a form of law?
Right.
And to my knowledge, it is ijma' of the scholars in Usul that abrogation is a systematic practice
right.
of Islamic law and Islam. Now, what he's saying, again, he's looking at the masalih and the mafasid,
mm-hmm.
the benefits and the harms. And you'll find some scholars now, some people nowadays, that they base their rulings strictly on the benefits and the harms. But there is a small distinction that needs to be understood. And that is what I mentioned earlier. The rulings of Islam are present and they stay until there is something that comes to, quote unquote, abrogate it. Now, when we talk about abrogation, does it necessitate relinquishment of the ruling that was before it? He says no, and that is depending on the time and the place, so on and so forth. Allah give you another option, for lack of better words. So stoning may be conducive in a certain society rather than others.
Right.
Right? So that's where he's looking at it, and he's I understand what he's saying is that, okay, it doesn't abrogate it and take it away. Rather, it's another choice and it's another option based on Allah's infinite knowledge, etc., etc. That's where you look back at what the scholars say about this issue. Because there's books written on this. There's books written on an-nasikh wa mansukh and abrogating abrogation. Firstly, as I said before, I don't know of any scholar of the past that mentioned that it is not. And any scholar... When I'm talking about of the past, I'm not only talking about in Islamic countries. I'm talking about scholars that are in, you know, you have a shelf to be, and he wrote what was called al-Waraqat, which is probably one of the best books when it comes to Usul al-Fiq and Maqasid al-Sharia, etc. And he's from Andalus, Spain, right? Now, applying those types of rulings in a non-Muslim country, obviously, you have to look at the benefits and the harms. That does not mean that you, with your aqidah and your belief, believe that the ruling is not obligatory. No, it's looking at the benefits and the harms in this country, right? We don't have, again, it goes back to a general rule. When applying laws of policy, public policy, are not applicable when you are a Muslim minority, right? So if someone came and said, look, my daughter committed zina, the back room over there, I'm going to go to Home Depot, you know, get the shovel, and you get some rocks. No, you don't do that. You know, if someone got caught stealing in the masjid, you go and get the machete, and no, you don't do that. Firstly, there has to be proof that that was done. Secondly, he's taken to court. There's a process. There's due process, even in an Islamic country.
Mm-hmm.
Right, it's not just, you know, any Muhammad, Joe, or Harry, right, comes and does it in the back room of the masjid. So with that, you know, that issue needs to be looked at. Okay, yeah, that ruling, we still believe it applies, and we believe that it has been abrogated, but the application of it is a different story. And that's where he's saying, from the application, it was never abrogated, so on and so forth. So I don't agree with him, but I understand where he's coming from, but that requires further look and scholarship within the what was mentioned in the books of Nasikh al-Mansukh and the scholars of the past, and looking at what his opinion is on certain verses, where Allah says, "Man nansakh min ayatin aw nusiha nati bi khayrin minha aw mithliha." Right? It's clear. We do not abrogate min ayatin from a verse or forget it. We come with something that is better than it or like it. What is his interpretation of that verse? Right? What is his interpretation of the hadith in the Prophet? Some said, "I used to prohibit you from this, now I..." Right? Right. Well, I mean, is he picking and choosing some of them, and why is he and why is he not? That's where you need to see totally what his principles are behind that. But I understand the logic behind it. That's something that a lot of times when contemporary thinkers, sometimes not scholars, but thinkers, they will consider the current situation and say, based on the benefit, the general benefit or overwhelming benefit of the masses, this doesn't apply. There are a number of questions that arise. Who are you to say that it's an overwhelming benefit? Right? First, that's the first question. Because when a scholar says it's an overwhelming benefit, he has to understand the locality, he has to understand the place, and a lot of times scholars are not knowledgeable of the context. That's why a lot of times, subhanAllah, I'd see a sheikh in Medina, they'd ask, his name is Abdul Muhsin al-Abad, he taught in the Haram, he still teaches in the Haram. They would ask him questions about their country, especially when it came to issues of fighting and stuff like that. He said, "I don't know, ask the scholars in your locality." He would tell us that, "I don't know, ask the scholars in your locality." So, yeah. And when it comes to fatawa, it's a different issue. Like when I talked about women driving, a lot of people hate Sheikh bin Baz because he gave the fatwa of women driving. But they have to understand that fatwa was specified for his people and his culture, because he knew his people. That's why translating books of fatawa is not, I don't recommend it, it's not something that is a good practice. Because the person that's translating is just a linguist. He's a translator. He doesn't understand the context of the fatwa. He's not a person of knowledge. He doesn't understand usul. Right? But translating the Quran, that's a whole different. That's why this chip, the ones that I used, they'll bring their understanding within the parentheses. That's what it is. I mean, there are certain translations, what they put in the parentheses is correct, you know, from what I've studied, but it's not a good read. You know, you're stopping, and you know, it's a lot of this. Yeah. Any other questions or comments? Jazakallah khairan. Didn't mean to keep y'all too late.